podcast all about colour. My name is Helen Disley and I'll be chatting today with Hugh Owens and Steve Westland.
So this week we're going to talk about yellow. I think we did blue and then red last week. This week it's yellow, a much happier colour. Is everyone feeling happier this week? You feeling happier, Helen?
Yay! much happier, much happier.
I'm still stuck in the blue.
Still feeling blue, yeah. I think I'm with Hugh as well. hopefully, better days around the corner. So, we've started a pattern, really, of talking about these colours, where we first of all talk about maybe ancient ideas about the colours or even about the pigments that have been used, and then move on towards more contemporary uses and meanings for the colours. So I remember when we talked about red, we noted that it was one of the earliest colours used by man in cave paintings, for example. Red ochre, which is a mineral just obtained from the ground. It turns out that yellow ochre was also around from the very earliest days. So a lot of those sort of browny, orangey colours you see in cave paintings were sort of yellow ochre, which was a sort of, it's a basically iron-based mineral. Of course, red ochre is also an iron-based mineral, but a slightly different compound of iron. So yellow is definitely one of the oldest pigments ever used. And some of the pigments that were used for yellow after that, actually quite a few of them weren't very healthy. So there was sort of a pigment called Orpiment, which was basically an arsenic, wasn't it? It's really bad for you, I think.
That's right, yeah. That was used in Egypt, I think, quite a lot for the gold and skin colours on the tombs and things. But
yeah, it was. In fact, even used as a medicine in China, even though it's very toxic, it's been used as a fly poison. It's been used on the tips of arrows to make poison. But it's a really striking yellow colour, and it became of interest to alchemists. These are the people who are trying to turn metal into gold. It was one of the things they were looking at as one of the ways to make gold. It was on the decorations of Tutankhamun's tomb, and lots of ancient Egyptian scrolls. And then you've got also sort of quite a few yellow pigments based on lead, which also isn't too healthy. Loads of very famous paintings by Vermeer, by Rembrandt, by Titian. You can see these sort of lead tin compound yellow pigments. So it's certainly, we've had yellow pigment around for a very, very long time.
Interesting, you find it in nature, don't you? Find it in carotenoids, don't you? So you see it in pigmentation in nature, and you know, there's funny stories of people who take too many vitamin pills, and there are carotenoids in the vitamin pills, and they pee yellow. it makes their pee quite yellow.
Yeah, so I also heard a story of someone who drank too much orange juice. Have you heard of that? And your skin can turn yellow. So, you know, whereas we talked before about, I think Helen made the point that blue is a pigment that doesn't occur that much naturally. But yellow, like red, is quite abundant in nature, isn't it? So the other thing that I think that's interesting about yellow, it's a colour that's been culturally significant. for a very, very long, a very, very long time. So one of the things that I think is quite interesting is the idea that we talked today about three primary colours. And in fact, colour scientists refer to this as trichromacy. We know the eye has got three cones. We have three attributes of colour. So trichromacy is all the rage.
Yeah, yeah.
But until about 1600, 1700, nobody talked about three in terms of colour. Scholars interested in colour, well, if you go back to ancient Greece, they had the idea not that three was important, but four was important. So, for example, Empedocles was probably the first Greek philosopher to write about colour. This is about 450 BC. And he believed that everything in the world was made up of four things: fire, water, air, and earth. And each of those four things was associated with a colour. Air was associated with white, water with black, fire with red, and earth with a sort of yellowy-green colour. And this is called the tetrads, the tetradic thinking. So we have Hippocrates, the sort of father of medicine, who talked about there being four body fluids: black bile, blood, yellow bile, and phlegm. And the idea was if you were deficient in one of these, it would affect your temperament. So there were four temperaments: melancholic, sanguine, choleric, and phlegmatic. And actually, this way of thinking about medicine continued on until easily the 1500s. And so did this idea of four. In fact, you can call it the four-colour doctrine. Aristotle also talked about four colours. And think about the fact that why are the four seasons? It's not particularly, there's no particular physical reason for it. There could be two or eight or any number. But there are four seasons. There are four ages of man: child, youth, man, greybeard. There are four parts of the day: morning, afternoon, evening, and night. This whole way of thinking about the world in terms of four dominated Western thinking about colour for a long, long time. The only other number that was important in the Western thinking was seven. So Aristotle also had an idea of there being seven basic colours, and this was based on white and black being the sort of extremes, and then you had purple, blue, green, yellow, and red. And seven was important because there were seven tones in the musical octave. There were seven bodies in the solar system that you could see with the naked eye: the sun, the moon, Mars, Mercury, Jupiter, Venus, Saturn. There were seven wonders of the ancient world, seven deadly sins, 7 days in the week, seven lucky gods in Japanese mythology. So this idea of four and seven was very important, but yellow was one of those colours. But in other parts of the world, they had a different way of thinking about it. So, for example, in China, they had not four as being important, but five. And part of this is related to the fact that their musical scale is different. They have a pentatonic scale. The music is fundamentally different to our music. And they believed that there were not four elements, but five elements. And these were water, which is black, wood, blue, fire, red, gold, white, and earth, which was yellow. And interestingly, each one was associated with the direction. So north was black, blue was east, south was red, west was white, and in the middle, most important of all, associated with earth, was yellow. So yellow was a really important colour culturally in China and lots of other countries. And it was only really with Newton and the work he did where this idea of four and seven and five started to be replaced by our modern understanding of colour, yeah. which is trichromacy.
I didn't realise that.
I think that's really interesting, Steve. Have you ever seen that book by Wallace Rimington on colour music, where he developed in the late 1890s, I think it's 1894, 1895, a musical method of playing based on colour. So colour was being associated with the different notes. So that he had his own patented colour organ and colour music. And he's got yellow as being E and yellow green as being F in his colour music. So interesting, those relationships have been there for a while.
Yeah, I think the link between music and colour is really long. And many people say that the reason that Newton claim to see seven colours in the spectrum, red, orange, yellow, green, indigo, blue, violet, was because he was still sort of influenced by that Greek thinking about seven. And he wanted it to be seven because there were seven intervals in an octave. On the one hand, I've always been slightly sort of sceptical of the relationship between music and colour. I think many people think there's an obvious relationship because they both involve frequencies at some point. But, of course, it's very different, as you know. But it's sort of almost a standing joke that a particular conference I go to every year, which I won't mention it because I'll be going there later this year. But every year, somebody still produces a paper on the relationship between colour and sort of music. And I always think, when will they stop? You know, just give it up, right? But what I think is interesting, where there is a link, I think, is in terms of emotion. Emotion is the thing that links.
Yeah.
So, for example, colours are associated with certain emotions, and then music also generates certain emotions, and then the idea that you could generate colours that actually are appropriate for a particular piece of music, I think that then there's a potential link, I think. You know, if you start talking about the emotional link between colour and music, I think that's sort of interesting. But in terms of frequencies, I don't think there's any relationship because, you know, the frequencies we talk about in light have got nothing to do with the frequencies we talk about in terms of sound, of course.
It is interesting. You do see more and more about these synesthetes who integrate their senses in a slightly different way from normal people. So I just wonder, you sort of see them combine and see and taste, yeah, things that we would ascribe perhaps a visual label to.
Yeah. So Kandinsky, funny enough, my son was doing his homework yesterday for a change, and he was doing his homework about Kandinsky and about synesthetics. So anyone who doesn't know, Kandinsky was an artist and a member of the Bauhaus. And he was famously synesthetic. So she said, this is people whose senses are slightly mixed. So they might, when they hear a sound, they might experience a colour, for example. And in fact, I think Kandinsky did have that particular form of it. But he also believed there was a relationship between colour and shape. So he said triangles are inherently yellow. Squares are red and circles are blue. Right? He believed that. And he produced, I'm thinking of one of his pieces of artwork, where he's trying to create a piece of work which is really unsettling. So what he's done, he's got all these shapes. So instead of doing yellow triangles, he's got like yellow circles.
Wow.
And instead of having blue circles, he's got like red circles. And for him, that probably was incredibly unsettling because they were the shapes were the wrong colours, right? But it didn't really work for other people, I don't think. But of course, for other people, it was just intriguing. Like why someone would do that. And you still see taught in some textbooks the idea that shapes and colours are associated. And I recently saw a paper in a journal, quite a respectable one, where they'd asked people about which colours are associated with this shape, with shapes, and they sort of found some evidence of what Kandinsky was saying. But of course, Kandinsky was synesthetic, but you have to remember that. And I can't help thinking that that paper was the result of a case where all the participants were art students who all knew of Kandinsky's theory. So it's like, you know, you don't know whether it's really the case or whether it's something we've culturally learned to adapt.
Yeah. Do you know whether people who associate colours with music or musical notes, is the colour that they tend to see a unique to them, or is it you know, everybody would hear an E and C?
I think it's unique
yellow.
To them.
Just,
I think it's unique to
like
them.
It's like a miswiring, isn't it? Something misfiring in the brain.
I never seen a good program on it where someone said for every number, he sees a colour. So you can say like 46, he'll say like olive brown, and then you can say 152, and he'll say like, you know, khaki. That's rather similar to olive brown, isn't it? Which shows you my limited imagination. when asked to pick two different colours, olive brown and khaki was about as far as I could go.
Have you had your colour vision checked recently?
Exactly. Funny enough, I was in a meeting today where I was talking about the blue colour on screen, and then everyone started arguing about saying it was green, but I was just approximating. It was green, actually. What was I talking about then?
Associated numbers, a different number for every colour.
Yeah, so you could argue, is this person making it up? But what they've done with these people, he can give this for any number, like 4,052. And he thinks it's yellow. That's a different colour, isn't it? Yellow.
Slightly.
And what you can show for these people is they're not making it up.
It's instant.
Unless they've got incredibly good memories, because they get it right every time. It's, you know, but it's different for different people, and some people it's colour and sound, and others it's taste and shape, for example, all sorts of things. It's really quite interesting. So one of the things that I think is particularly interesting about yellow is, you know, when you sort of you look on the internet, you find out that blue means this and red means that, and we've been talking in these past few weeks about the fact that the meanings of colours are very varied and depend upon context and culture, etc. But also that all of these colours have got positive and negative associations. So, for example, blue is trustworthy. Blue is the colour of trust. We talked about that last week. But it's also the colour of depression and sadness. And I think this notion between colours having positive and negative meanings is really evident with yellow. It produces quite strikingly different reactions in people. And I think until I haven't found any negative associations of yellow, certainly before about the year 1000. He was frowning then, but he didn't know I was going to say before the year 1000.
True.
It was a positive colour. You know, Egypt, it was the colour of the
sun,
God of the sun. And didn't they paint dead pharaohs in yellow and everything? You know, I think it was used. It was a really positive colour, but over the centuries it became to have negative associations. And if you sort of talk to people now, or if you do a survey and say to people, what's your favourite colour? You know, the on average, blue scores very high, independent of culture or gender. Yellow, on average, scores really low. Loads of people put yellow as their least favourite colour. Yet for me, it is infinitely more preferable to blue, right? I really don't like blue. I love yellow. I like pink and yellow and red. I like the really bright colours. But the majority of people prefer the blues, maybe the greens.
I wonder if it's how people think about it when you say, what's your favourite colour? Like, if I was in a yellow room, I'd feel really happy. But if I had to wear yellow, that would make me quite unhappy. Yeah, I would not want to wear it. But yellow as an outside influence on me is really uplifting and happy.
It is for me as well, but I guess it might not be for everyone. I've been writing a piece recently. I won't go into the details of it, but if you look at the effect of colour on us, there's sort of two main mechanisms, I think. There's a sort of what you might call a physiological mechanism, which is, you know, colour just activates the cones, and then maybe it sends a signal to the hypothalamus, and you've got this almost involuntary reaction to colour and light. And those reactions that people have are probably quite common between different people because it's just a basic physiology. But then you've also got what you might call the cognitive or psychological responses. So colour preference, I think, would be one of these. So for this to work, you have to see the colour. And then it's a question of, well, what do you associate with that? You know, what does it remind you of?
Mm-hmm.
And I think there you have, I think, lots of differences between how people respond. So, you know, some people just say, blue is fantastic, I love it. And others say, I hate it. But on average, actually, more people do tend to like blue than yellow, it has to be said. And what people really don't like is dark yellow and dark red and orange, because they look horrible.
Murky, yeah.
They look horrible for lots of people.
One of the biggest associations with yellow is probably, like you mentioned before, is that, you know, the sun. And I think there's a lot of countless religions that have their gods and sun gods and things being depicted as wearing yellow or being associated with yellow. It can be a very sort of highly symbolic colour. In that sense, Buddhism, the saffron robes, obviously saffron as a colorant is hugely expensive.
Yeah.
So associated with, you know, you'd have to be someone of great importance to wear it. And only Buddha and his followers were allowed to wear saffron robes originally, apparently. In Hinduism, Krishna is often depicted in yellow.
So last week we were talking about the fact that some of these associations, you can go back a long way and sort of think about where it came from very early days. And as I said, the idea that yellow is a negative colour, that the fact it's associated sometimes with envy, jealousy, lying, dishonour,
cowardice.
Treason, cowardice. It's a false colour that can't be trusted.
Mm.
Some people say these ideas were sort of reinforced by that tetradic Greek thinking I was telling you about. Do you remember I said that you had the four temperaments of sort of medicine? One was a choleric temperament, which is where you're violent, unstable, rancorous, hypocritical. You know, not looking at anyone in particular, Hughes. and that was associated with yellow bile. So, you know, it could be you go back really a long, long way where some of these ideas started to emerge. We do actually, believe it or not, do some a little bit of reading before we come to this podcast. I do anyway. Read a couple of things. And I did read one thing, which is a test for Helen and Hugh to see if you've been doing your reading, which is why...
I have been reading, but I haven't been reading the same things as you.
Why and when did the yellow jersey come into play for the Tour de France? Any thoughts?
No. The funny thing is, though, I think I have read about this because... Nigel's really interested in the Tour de France,
yeah,
but I
thought
you'd
know.
I know you like
cycling. Apparently, it came in the 1919 race, and it's partly because the sponsors of the race was a newspaper that was printed on yellow paper.
That's really interesting. It's one of those automatic associations, isn't it? That we, you know, they get a yellow jersey, but from a lowly beginning, really.
Yeah.
I thought you were only interested in the Tour de Yorkshire anyway.
Tour de Yorkshire was great. You know, it actually came right past our house. You know,
fantastic. Along your road. Yeah.
You wouldn't believe how fast they go. It's over in about 15 seconds. Everyone's passed. And there's literally a hairpin bend about 20 metres from our house. But despite that, they come hurtling through. Everybody's out there with the deck chairs and their coffee, and then it's all over.
Umbrellas.
And the other thing I was reading about, which was interesting, was the yellow card in football. Do you anyone know about that? Yeah. So what? One, for those who don't know, yellow card is shown when you get booked. And apparently it was first used, it was either 1970 or 1974 World Cup. And before that, the referee just wrote your name in his book.
But
in the World Cup in 70 or 74, I forget which one it was, the referee sort of showed you the yellow card. Then I remember being outraged in the World Cup that was in America. Now, what year was that in? Round about, was it about 2004, 6? That sort of, was it earlier? I don't know, round about that time. And if you remember this, Hugh, but they started referring to a player being yellow carded. Yeah. As if yellow card is a verb, not a noun. Yeah, and it drove me mad that this player was yellow carded. But actually, it stuck, didn't it? And now we talk about people being yellow carded or red carded. In a way, it only shows that language, of course, evolves. And that's how it should be. And if you think about it, I shouldn't have been outraged. It shows you what sort of person I am, because if you think about it, when I said people were booked, a book is a noun also, so that was also turned into a verb long before the Americans got hold of the World Cup. But yeah, the phrase yellow carded and red carded is pretty common. So one final thing to mention, I will mention, is because we talked about the red light district last week, and Helen had a theory, which she put forward, not hers of course, originally, about why that might have been the case. And of course we didn't mention it probably the week before, but we talked about blue movies. Or blue jokes, don't you? Which are risque jokes or maybe slightly sexual jokes. But I did hear that in China, they don't use the phrase a blue movie. They use the phrase a yellow movie.
You seem to know an awful lot about this, Steve.
Indeed. I've actually been researching it all week. In all seriousness, I sent a message to all my Chinese PhD students. I had quite a few PhD students from China. I sent a message to them about 2:30 today and said, is it true that in China you refer to yellow movies rather than blue movies? And they said, it is true. Now, of course, they could be just winding me up, you know, because they knew I was going to record this podcast. But one of them did come up with a suggestion of why it might be the case, and it was to do with a political movement and a situation where books became colour-coded, depending upon the content of the book. And yellow books were books about sex. Because I don't have any of those, Hugh, but, you know. I don't know why they chose yellow for that.
It's interesting that they would choose yellow. I mean, I think the sort of the cultural references to colours that we've talked about through all of these podcasts are really interesting and really conflicting, because, you know, yellow movies potentially regarded as an not such a nice association with yellow, and yet and that's in China, and yet yellow as a colour in China has been really important. You know, in the Forbidden City, you could only imperial buildings could have yellow coloured roofs and things like that. So it's like the sort of the polar opposite meanings and associations with all of these colours is really interesting.
And similarly, we've talked about how blue is quite a positive colour for lots of people, and yet a blue movie or a blue joke is something maybe a little bit negative. Which also speaks to the thing that we've been talking about all the time, about the fact that colours have really many a particular colour can have many meanings, and it really depends upon the context in which it's used, and also the cultural situation in which it's used. Mm. I saw an interesting quote the other day about colour being colour is essentially a cultural phenomenon. At the end of the day, we can talk about, as Hugh and I do, we can talk about cones and brain responses and the retina and the lateral geniculate nucleus. I need to throw that in because I can say it. But actually, what makes colour so interesting, and the reason that we're having these podcasts at all, is because colour is a cultural phenomenon.
It is, but I think it is also interesting from that perceptual point of view, in that yellow in particular is produced in a couple of ways. We can either have a spectral yellow, or a mixture of red and green seems to also give us that impression of yellow as well. So it's a little bit different from a lot of the other colours in the visible spectrum that people think about. The other thing that's interesting about yellow is it seems quite difficult to read yellow unless it's encapsulated in a border. So if you just put if you put some yellow text up, unless it has a highly contrasting background, it's often very, very difficult to pick that out, even though it appears to be in a sweet spot for our cones and the way that our cones will code that part of the visible spectrum.
Yeah, maybe it's because it's one of the brightest colours, isn't it?
It is, and you know, when we look at that in terms of things like dyes in textiles, when we measure that using the international systems, yellows are always a problem because they're so bright, they're almost brighter than a lot of the whites that we look at as well. So it is an interesting colour. You sort of see that watercolour effect with it, and how it can bleed towards sharp edges and boundaries. But there are some quite interesting, unique meanings of of yellow in different cultures. Now, for me, it's a bright, cheerful, warm colour. But bright marigold might be associated with death in some areas of Mexico. It seems to be a colloquial term that's used for an insane asylum. The in Russia, they use the term yellow house. So the context is quite big. I think in Japan, yellow often represents things like courage as well.
Mm.
So context is everything.
Well, we've talked about red, blue, and yellow. It's obvious what we talk about next week, isn't it?
Dun, dun, dun.
What do you think, Helen?
Green,
yeah,
obviously.
Green. Because red, yellow, green, blue are the four psychological primaries and the four so-called unique hues. So I think it would only be fair to talk about.
Green. I think we can only talk about green next week if on the soundtrack you include Kermit's song "It's Not Easy Being Green" from the Muppets.
I will do my best. It's because you've mentioned it now, it can appear on this podcast. But before we go, we need to have a title for this podcast. The colour of
deceit.
Sunshine. Warmth.
And if anybody has any comments, if you go to our podcast page, which is swestland.podbean.com, I think, you can actually leave a comment there.
A nice
If anyone
one.
Knows...
Yeah.
Yeah, well, hopefully, yeah. If anyone knows why yellow movies are so called in China, he wants to let us know, please go there and let us know. But until then, see you next week.
See you.
Bye.
Bye.
Goodbye. Bye.